Thank you very much, Elisa, Idris, Kevin, for this kind invitation. I apologize for not being there. I'm very sorry. I really tried, but there were too many complications, so it was not possible. So, sorry. I will speak about joint work with Sergio Conti and Matteo Focardi concerning the approximation of functions of bounded variations, in fact, the special functions of bounded variation that can have possibly infinite job sets. So approximation results are everywhere in calculus of variation. So they are on the basis of several arguments. So for example, in the simplest one, in simplest case, I have a formula or I have a property that holds for regular objects, regular functions or regular sets, for example, and I would like to establish a generalization of it for more complicated objects. I use an approximation result. Or, for example, in gamma convergence argument, relaxation arguments, or integral representation. So approximation results are very useful, and for this reason, the literature is full of results of this type. And in this talk, I would like to speak about a result of this type, but for a particular class of functions. And in particular, I'm interested in two functions U, which are special functions of bounded variation on some open bounded set with Lipschitz boundary, so a standard regularity property on omega. For which we have an additional constraint of type some energy that will be specified later is finite. So this is the property that will play the role and will distinguish some between different situations. And given a function of this type, I wonder if I can approximate this U. So if there exists a sequence UK, still SBB, but more regular. In my case, more regular will mean piecewise affine. So in my case, UK will be piecewise affine with a piecewise affine jump set. Such that UK converts to U in some suitable sense that will be clear later, and in particular that preserves the relevant property, which is the energy in this case. So in particular, what I need is that the energy of UK converts to the energy of U. So I would like to approximate you with something which is of the same type that can be really replace you in some problem I want to solve. As I said, in the literature, there are several results of this type, but for particular energies, the standard one, the standard case, so let me write literature. The standard case is when the energy has growth one in volume and in surface, in the surface and volume terms. So, for example, the model case is the variation of U, and that is the gradient of U with the exponent one plus the variation. The amplitude, the integral of the amplitude of the jump. And this is a very standard, is one of the first approximation results that is studied in the theory of BV functions. And the second classical case studied in the literature is the Mumford-Shah case, where the energy is of type gradient of U squared plus the measure of the jump set. So this is a Mumford-Shah type. And so what is the difference between these two models? So it's the growth, of course, of the two terms of the volume and of the surface terms. In the first case, we have growth one in the first and growth one in the second. And in the second case, in the Monfort-Shah case, we have growth two for the gradient and a constant for the density of the jump set. In particular, let me notice that in the first case, the growth is the same for the two terms. In the second case, the growth is not the same for the two terms, but we have the finiteness of this energy in particular implies the fact that the measure of the jump set, of course, is finite. I'm interested in a third type of energy, which is not very much studied in the literature, and morally is the case in which we still have a different behavior, a different growth between the two terms, volume and surface. But we don't have the finiteness of the jump set. We don't have any term which ensure the finiteness of the jump set. So something which is morally of this type. So integral of gradient two squared, for example, plus, for example, the square root of the jump. Of course, this doesn't imply. So in this case, the measure of the jump set is not finite in general. So it may be finite, but in general it is infinite. This type of problem arises, this model arises in fracture mechanics, in models in which we have coercive type models, in which the coercive part, the surface part, has a superlinear growth, essentially. So this is what I have in mind. So this is what I would like to study. In the literature, this case is not really completely understood. There are some results by De Filippis, Fusco and Pratelli, but they are not completely satisfactory because, in fact, they provide an approximation of U of this type in some sense, which is not the convergence of the energy. So it's a weaker sense. So it gives an approximation of U with the energy of finite of this type, but it doesn't provide that EUK converts to E of U. And then, of course, in practical problems, cannot be employed. So our result, the result we proved with the Sergio Matteo, was born because we had in mind this problem, but in fact it applies to a more general case. So it will include also the case of a jump set which is finite, and it includes also the growth one of functionals. So let me state first the theorem, and then I will give you the main ideas of the proof of the construction. So the theorem, which is in fact already online, is a preprint 2023, says that if U is an SBV function, still also vectorial, so Rm. If U is in SBV such that some energy is finite, what is this energy? Now I give you precisely what kind of energy has to be finite. An energy of type gradient of U P dx plus an energy Ju of some density G0 amplitude of U, finite, where P, in fact, can be also one. So P is greater or equal to one and finite. And G0 satisfies some standard properties. So G0 is, in fact, non-decreasing, sub-additive, non-decreasing. increasing sabbative and G0 of 0 is 0, so we don't have we are not bounded in the origin, so we are not far from 0 in the origin, so this includes the case of the square root, for example. So G0 is non-decreasing sub-additive, and also G0 minus 1 of 0 is the only point 0. The model picture of G0 is something of this type. Okay, so if U is of this type, we don't have any growth hypothesis on G0. So if we have U of this type, then we can find a sequence UK, which is SBV and also all'infinity omega Rm, such that UK is in fact piecewise affine, is better than SBV and all'infinity. UK is piecewise affine with jump, which is included in phases of symplexes. So in fact, this UK is piecewise affine on the decomposition in symplexes of Rn. So I write like this on a decomposition in symplexes of Rn. And also we have good convergences. UK converges to U in L1. Also, it converges strictly BV, also strictly in area, in fact, strictly in area. But in fact, we can say more, we can say that we have a convergence, separate convergence of volume energies and surface energies for two classes, for two different classes of volume densities and surface densities. So in particular, we have that psi gradient of U, K converges to psi gradient of U. For which psi? For all psi which satisfy essentially the same growth as the one in the model, so growth P. So for every psi such that the norm of psi is less than a constant time psi P plus 1. And also we have convergence of a class of surface energies, so G UK nu UK, J UK, converging to G U nu, where G is good with respect to the G0 given in the statement, so in the hypothesis. So for all G satisfying the following properties. The first two properties are in fact just saying that it is well defined. So in particular, G the minus S minus nu must be equal to G S nu, so this says that it doesn't depend on the orientation, on the choice of the normal. So it's just a definition and well positioned condition. G zero nu is equal to zero for every nu, and the third one, which is the most important, is the sub-additivity condition. But since it depends on two variables, we have to be more precise. So I write here. So the third condition is a sort of sub-additivity, but with respect to G0. So S plus S prime nu must be less than gs nu plus a constant g0 espran. Okay, so we have in fact all good convergence properties. In fact, all energies of the same type, of similar type of the one giving the constraint in the hypothesis converge. And finally, I just add some particular case, which includes the well-known cases. So in particular, the Sobolev case, if U is W1P, then in fact UK is W1P. If gradient of U is zero, then gradient UK is zero, so rigid corresponds to rigid. And if the measure of the jump is finite, then the jump of JUK is finite. And we also have the convergence for a new class of surface energies, which take into account this condition. So here, for simplicity, I just write and we have convergence of the measures. But in fact, here I mean that I have convergence for a class of energies of type G, so I can rewrite a property like this, but in place of having the property 2, which says that G0 is 0 in 0 when the jump is 0, I have to take into account that the measure is finite, so in fact I have to be far from 0. Okay, so this statement says that we are able to construct a sequence of piecewise affine function on with piecewise affine jump set converging in energy. And also the convergence I wrote here in the first property, in the second point here, is strictly BV, strictly area, again, are convergences of energy type. A convergence of strongly type for UK cannot be expected, for example, because the jump set may be the intersection between the jump set JUK and JU may be empty or negligible. So in fact, we have a strong convergence BV, but not on the level of UK, but on the level of a composition with a Billiches diffeomorphism. So throwing a Billiches diffeomorphism, we still have a stronger convergence, which is the BV strong convergence. Okay, so this is the main theorem we have. In the remaining time, I would like to give you first the main construction, which is on the basis of the proof of it. And if I have time, also the ideas of the main steps in the global construction. So first, the main construction. The main construction is the following. Can be thought on just one simplex. So we consider a simplex, for example, in 2D. So in ND, it works in a similar way. So we focus on a simplex and we suppose to have U, which is SBV on this simplex scalar. U is also scalar. What is crucial in this statement and what I try to highlight in the first slide is that it's important the fact that the growth of the two terms is different. This means that we cannot expect a mixture of surface and jump because they behave in a different way. So the good way to have a similar approximation result is that we have to expect separation, a separate convergence for volume and surface, and then we have to provide an explicit construction which takes into account this separation of volume and jump contribution. So we supposed to have a function u as vv of the triangle. We would like to extract some information from u in order to provide a good piecewise affine function which preserves and separately these information. So the information we will extract are following are the values of u. Suppose that the function is defined everywhere. So I, for simplicity, in this moment, I am considering u defined in every point. So the first I call a1, a2, and a3 the vertices. The first information I would like to extract from u is the values of u on the vertices. I call uj with j1 and plus one, the morally three in the two dimensional case, the real values corresponding to u evaluated in aj. The other, another information I would like to extract on u is the behavior on the segments. So I focus on what is it, its behavior on the contour, so on the segments of the triangle. And in particular, what I observe is that in order to go from the value u a I to another value u a j, since u is SBV, can be of two types. So in order to go from a value to another, I go either with a regular slope or jumping. So in order to pass from UAI to UAJ, I can go either with a slope or jumping. And this can be done several times, of course. Okay, so I would like to extract these two information. So the slope, the global regular slope and the global jump. What does it mean? First, the jump. Looking at the one segment, A1, A3, for example, I associate to A1, A3 a quantity that I call S1, 3, and analogously S2, S3, 2, S2, 1, three quantities which are morally the global jump along the segment. This means I call Sij, that is morally the sum of the jump of u restricted to the segment Ai, Aj. And finally, the third quantity I extract is the regular slope, as I said. So another real quantity, Xi1, 3, Xi3, 2, Xi2, 1, that in fact can be defined from the previous two quantities, and is in fact given by uj minus ui minus sij. So this means that in order to pass from ui to uj, either I jump or I do a regular slope. These three quantities, so these are given properties. So These are in fact given. I extract some information which are in fact given. And as a byproduct, by the definition of these three quantities, in fact, I have that there is a compatibility conditions among them, which is of type C12 plus C23 plus C31 plus S12 plus S23 plus S31 equal to 0. This is a compatibility condition which essentially says that if I do a round, so I go from A1 to A3 to A2 and then I come back to A1, I get 0. So after a complete round, I get 0. And this is important from what I'm going to say. So given these three quantities, I call 1, 2, and 3, I get the following proposition. I get that there exists, so given 1, 2, and 3, there exists a function v, which is in fact piecewise affine on T on the triangle, and such that the gradient of V can be estimated with the gradient, so with Xi. So the gradient of V is estimated by a constant times Xi. The jump of V can be estimated by the a constant 3 times the jump S. Xi and S are the vector of components or the matrix of components Sij, Xij respectively. So the volume is estimated by the volume, the jump by the jump. And also we have the fact that the measure of the jump set of V is less than the measure of the boundary of the triangle. And I also have an explicit definition of V that is in fact an explicit characterization of V of the piecewise affine function. If I know V everywhere on the boundary, then I know V. And V, in fact, restricted to AI, AJ, T, what is the function that starts from UI, then it has a slope psi IJ, T, and then it jumps S, IJ, when after the middle point, so for a characteristic function t greater than 1 half. So what is this? This is t in 0, 1. What is this definition? What is this this function v? The function v is constructed in this way. So I started from UI, so I started from A1, for example. I go in the direction A2, so I'm looking at this segment, for example. I start from A1, I do a regular slope up to the middle, and then I jump, so I jump here. I repeat this for each segment, and I have a precise definition. So I have the definition of the slopes in each half segment. And what I'm constructing is a function which is affine, in fact, in each one of these tetrahedron. Okay, and the definition is precisely this one. In fact, it is easier working in the baricenter coordinates, in convex coordinates. So it's easy. It's the easiest way to see this. But in fact, the construction is this. So I take all the jump along one segment, I pack all the jumps in just one point. So I pick the sum of all the jumps along the segment and I pack it in just one point. I do this for every segment. And then the rest of the definition is straightforward. I just take the affine function with the remaining regular slope. So this is the main construction, which provides separated estimates, so gradient with gradient and jump with jump. Now, how to use this for functions? So this in fact can be done for quantities which are just real and not associated to a function u, but of course I would like to apply this to a function u. So the consequence for a function u is that I can apply this several times in a decomposition. So if I have a decomposition, I take my domain, I take a decomposition in simplexes. So this is my decomposition in simplexes. And I do exactly that construction in each simplex. And so on. In this way, so in of course extracting the good quantities. So in particular, I take precisely u, a, j, the sum of the jump, and here I haven't written, but this is the gradient of u restricted to a, I, a, j. So taking the good quantities, of course, I have to choose the decomposition because in general, u is not defined everywhere. Then I have to translate a bit in order to be sure that there are enough decompositions that satisfy good properties, but this can be done. So in fact, I'm able to construct, so there exists, I can construct a global piecewise affine function. So there exists PU, piecewise affine, such that it satisfies several properties, and in particular, it satisfies a property of type the gradient of PU to the power P is less than the gradient of u to the power p, and a property of type the jump, the integral of g0 of the jump of pu is less than a constant times the integral g0 of the jump of u. Okay. Now, this is not the end, in fact. This is not the global construction. The problem is the fact that these estimates are good, and also these estimates are good in the sense that they estimate volume with volume and surface with surface, but we lost something. Remember that I would like to get the convergence of the energy, so with the coefficient 1. I don't want to lose a coefficient here. So this means that this construction is nice. It goes in the right direction, but in fact, it cannot be applied everywhere in our domain. It has to be applied to the powder. So I have first to remove the most of the jump, essentially, and then to apply this to the powder in order that I don't lose so much. So this is the idea. And so in these last minutes, I give you the idea of the global construction. So the global construction is done in several steps. And the crucial point, the main point of the construction is that we need two scales. So we have to argue at two scales. So the first point, so this is the construction means the proof of the theorem I gave at the beginning. So take you with finite energy. So U as VV such that the energy is finite. Now the first step is to decompose, to find a good scale, small scale, in order that in each cube of a decomposition of Rn, so I call delta this scale, in each cube of this decomposition, the jump is very close to a C1 variety. So in each cube, Q delta, in Q delta, in each cube Q delta, we have that JU is very close to a C1 variety. Very close, what does it mean? In the sense of the energy. Closed in the sense of G0, of the energy which gives the finiteness of the given constraint, of the given energy. Also the gradient of U is very close to a constant, eta, where, again, what does it mean? Very close in the sense of the energy, which is LP, in the LP sense. So in this first step, we replace JU by something which is C1, which is closed in energy to the original jump. Now, in the second step, we focus on each Q delta. So we take one Q delta. And in each Q delta, we first approximate. Again, we replace. We would like something which is piecewise affine with a piecewise affine jump set. So we first replace the jump set by something which is piecewise affine. So we introduce a new scale epsilon, which is less than delta. And at this scale, I approximate the jump with something which is piecewise affine. So JU is replace JU, that means the C1 variety, in fact, the C1 variety is replaced by something which is a polyhedron, sorry, which is the polyhedron, but polyhedron jump set. So piecewise affine, a piecewise affine set, I write like this. Okay, now I'm going to apply the proposition, but first, as I said, I have first to remove the most of the jump, because otherwise I lost the coefficient. In order to remove the loss of the jump, what I have to do is to extend, in fact, I have first to extend the function without creating jump on the interface. So again, I focus on the function U defined on this part, for example, on this part of the jump, I extend it on the other side. So this is an extension, a suitable, of course, a suitable extension result, which doesn't create, not creating jump. With zero jump, with zero jump on the interface. And I do the same on the other side. So if I restrict u here, I extend it on the other side, and without creating a jump. Hence, I get two extensions of u which have globally a small jump set, because the most of the jump set was on the interface. So if I not reflect, I really extend u on the other side without creating jump, in fact, I have removed most of the jump. So to these two functions, I can apply my proposition. So apply the proposition. So the piecewise affine approximation to these two extensions. And here there is a remark. The proposition has to be applied with the right scale. So at a scale which is less than delta, so it can be the same scale as the jump set, at a scale epsilon less than delta. So the important fact is that epsilon is less than delta. They can be different, but the important fact is that epsilon is less than delta. And this means that T is in fact of size epsilon. So T was the triangle. So the triangle here of the decomposition, or the triangle here of this decomposition, has to be size epsilon. So I do this approximation for these two extensions. So I apply the proposition to these two extensions. This provides two piecewise affine functions. And finally, I glue together. I glue the two approximations. On the two sides. So the one was has been constructed by extending. So I have extended, I have applied the proposition, and I got something like PU1, so the first extension. And so I define a new function, which is PU1 on one side and PU2 on the other side, where PU1 and PU2 were, U1 and U2 were the two extensions, U1 here and U2 here. Okay, and this concludes the structure, the idea of the proof. Thank you very much for your attention.